Morning, everybody. Are there any joys or concerns anyone wants to share today?
Once I get this mic on, I want to thank Steve and Sarah for playing last Sunday at church. It was Color Fest. The church was closed, but Steve and Sarah played music for an hour or two, maybe 2 hours, and we did have a few people stop in and enjoy it. One couple stayed, I think, about an hour. So we appreciate very much your playing music to keep the church open. Thank you.
Yes, double thank you. I stopped to see Alice this week, and she seems to be doing really good. They all seem to be cheerful, and Alice actually had our council meeting at her house. She never fails. I would like some prayer for my brother Bill Eiler. He had knee surgery and did fine with that, but now he's very sick with a high fever and some pneumonia and a few other things. So if anybody can say a couple prayers for him, I'd appreciate it. Sarah's music recital is this afternoon at 3 p.m. and all are welcome here. Our pot pie and country ham sandwich sale is this Wednesday, October 25th. And Pastor Sharisa Simpson Rice, the Associate Conference Minister, will lead our worship service on October 29th. And Veterans Day, please tell family and friends to join us for Veterans Day, November the 5th. It's always such a nice service and much appreciated by very many. So please, please tell people about us. Reverend Jeff Knoll will deliver the Veterans Day message and will be our supply pastor on November the 12th. Pastor Ellsbury, that gentleman that's sitting here with us today, his surgery has been rescheduled for November the 8th. Please continue to keep him in your prayers for his upcoming surgery. Please join me now in the call to worship. We've come to worship God, who loved us before we were yet born, who knows us even better than we know ourselves, whose presence never leaves us, and whose love for us never ceases. This is our God. Let's worship together. Please join me now in the hymn of praise, page 466, What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
Thank you. Please join me in the call to confession. Merciful God, Jesus' life and the manner of his death demonstrated that there was literally no limit to his love. Living a human life as we do, he demonstrated how the values of your kingdom are different from the world's values and how your standards are different from the world's standards. We live in the world also and are exposed to all the trials and temptations that the world's values and standards place on us as Christians. So we welcome Jesus' prayer for his disciples, his prayer also for us. Jesus prayed that his followers would be one, as he and God are one. Please join me. Forgive us when we contribute to disunity or conflict in any of our relationships with one another. Forgive us for blaming you, O God, for distressing for difficult times, and for believing that we can deal with problems in our own strength. Keep us holy, O God, and empower us to be faithful witnesses of the truth of the gospel as long as we live. As Jesus' disciples, and in his name, I pray.
Amen.
The truth of God's love is this. Before we knew God, before we knew love, and before we understood the depth of our sin, the reconciling work of Christ was done. Through the Holy Spirit, we reach out the one who lived, died, and rose again to reveal God's resurrection power to us and for us. Hear and believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
We are forgiven, loved, and for free.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
A reading from the Holy Scripture. I'm starting with Psalm 139. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in behind and in front, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high, I cannot attain it. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea, even there, O Lord, your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and night wraps itself around me, even the darkness is not dark to you, O Lord. The night is as bright as the day. The darkness is as light to you. A reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 17, verses 1 through 6 and 20 to 26. Jesus is praying for his disciples. After Jesus has spoken these words, he looked up to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, so that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all people, to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. I ask not only on behalf of these, but on behalf of those who believe in me through their word, that they may all be one, as you, Father, are in me, and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given them, so you have sent me, and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I desire that those also whom you have given me may be with me where I am, to see my glory, which you have given me before you loved me, before the foundation of the world. Righteous Father, the world does not know you, but I know you, and these know you that you have sent me. I made your name known to them, and I will make it known, so that the love with which you have loved me may be in them, and I in them. It's a deep prayer. I thought we could unpack a little bit this morning. In John 17, Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane praying, and the very next day, he is going to the cross. So he's about to leave our world of time and go back to his world of eternity. Just before John 17, chapters 14 through 16, Jesus gives an amazing picture to us of what's coming. This is where he says, I go to prepare a place for you. In my Father's house there are many mansions. This is where he says, in this world you'll have tribulation, but be encouraged, I have overcome the world. And this is where he predicts the coming of the Holy Spirit to be our comforter and our guide in our life here. And then here in John 17, Jesus lifts his eyes to heaven and says, Father, the hour has come. Martin Lloyd-Jones was the chapel minister at Westminster Chapel in England for 30 years, and he wrote the following on John 17. He said, in John 17, Jesus prays the greatest prayer that was ever offered on earth, and it followed the greatest sermon ever preached on earth. I like that. In verse 20, Jesus prays, neither pray I for them alone, but for them also which will believe on me through their word. So here Jesus is praying for all Christians in all future times. In other words, he's praying for you and for me. It's a pretty exciting thought to think that we're on Jesus' prayer list. You know, the world stresses us out all week. And then on Sunday, we return here to this beautiful sanctuary. On this beautiful day, we come to renew our faith. We come for fellowship with our friends. And I don't know anything more comforting, anything more faith-building than knowing that when Jesus' hour came, he was praying for us. And so we forget, I forget, the enormity, the awesomeness of God's plan for us. And this is Jesus' prayer, that God's plan would be fulfilled in each of us. So briefly this morning, I'd like us to reflect on Jesus' great prayer, on God's plan for us, and our part, our participation in the prayer and the plan. In verse 3, Jesus says, and this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. Eternal life isn't just about time. It's about a quality of life. It's about spending eternity with God and Jesus, knowing him. You know, if we are in Christ, our eternal life has already begun. We are in faith in that. As Paul said in 1 Corinthians, darkly as in a mirror, we behold Christ, we behold our heaven, but in the future we'll see him as he is. In verse 4, Jesus prays, I have finished the work which you have given me to do. And what was Jesus' work? Well, it was to save mankind. In Luke 19, verse 10, Jesus came to seek and save that which was lost. That was God's plan. That's what Jesus did. We should reflect for a moment that Jesus didn't just take away our sins, as wonderful as that is, but he took away our entire heredity of sin, the DNA of sin that's in each of us and each person all the way back to Adam. Christ took that away. It's deeper beyond our sins. And so Christ's work was and is God's plan. You know, God never changed his plan from day one, chapter 3 of Genesis. It was a huge restoration project, probably the greatest in the universe. It's born of his love and his infinite grace. When we read the Bible, we're reading the record of God's reclamation of the human race. It's interesting, when you read scripture, you notice who's doing the work. It's God. It's God as the active agent in the Bible. So what is God's plan? It's for our adoption into the family of God. His plan is perfect. It's once and for all. And that's why Christ on the cross said in a voice, "It is accomplished. It's done. All done." The blood of Christ can never be canceled. It can never be gone. It will always be there for our saving grace. Romans chapter 8, Paul writes it this way: "We have not received the spirit of bondage, again to fear. We receive the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. And the Spirit bears witness to our spirit that we are the children of God. And the children and heirs, heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ. If so be that we suffer with him, that we may glorify with him." In verse 23, Jesus prays, "I and them, thou and me, that they may be made perfect in one, that the world may know that you sent me, and you have loved me, and loved them as you love me." You know, when we believe and receive Christ, our salvation is instant. But just like the TV commercials that come on late at night, we say, "But wait, there's more." And that is that God loves us too much to leave us as we are. His work is just beginning. And the making perfect is the work of the Holy Spirit. And it goes on our whole life. How does the Holy Spirit work? I don't know. But bit by bit, every day of our life, the Holy Spirit is making us more like our Lord Jesus. Max Lucado, the Christian author, had a good analogy for it. He said, it's like being on the anvil, and the craftsman is pounding away at us, pounding us into shape so that we may be a useful tool in the hands of our Lord. That's the work that goes on. It's our sanctification beyond our salvation. At the end of Christ's prayer, he says that the love with which you loved me may be in them and I in them. What an amazing thing. God loves us in the very same way that he loves Jesus. We have the same unity. We're in him and he in us. So we've looked at Jesus' prayer, which shows us that our lives are not accidents. You and I, our children, come from the great heart, the great mind of a living God. In Psalm 139, that's why we read, his hand is upon us. Just imagine that. His hand is upon you right now. And we've looked at the great plan of God for our adoption. That our adoption is more than we realize. It's beyond forgiveness, as wonderful as forgiveness is. Adoption means we're in his family, that we can have a close and warm relationship with our Father God in heaven. He takes us into union with himself. When we pray the Lord's Prayer, we pray, our Father who art in heaven. We're praying as the adopted children of God. What then is our part? What's our participation? Well, Scripture tells us very clearly. Trust God. Receive Christ as our Lord and Savior, and live a life of faith and obedience to the Holy Spirit. We can build our faith on the assurance of Jesus' prayer that we've looked at and God's eternal, wonderful plan. When asked to define faith, Martin Luther defined it. He said, faith is a living, deliberate confidence in the grace of God. A living, deliberate confidence in the grace of God. It's not bound by rules, it's a relationship. Faith gives us the key to a life of gratitude and joy and peace. In Romans chapter 8, again, there's a wonderful phrase about hope. It says, we're saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man sees, why does he yet hope for it? But if we hope for what we don't see, then do we in patience wait for it. And that's the key. We are saved by our hope, by our waiting in patience. And that's how the Holy Spirit purifies us and works in us. So our participation is to be assured of our salvation, of our adoption into the family of God. And here in John 17, we have Jesus' word for that. So let's go forth this week remembering we are God's beloved children, that heaven is our home, that our Savior is our big brother, and that we will trust God and build up our faith. Jim O'Neill was a 65-year-old pilot on his way to Colchester, England one day from Glasgow, Scotland. He was flying his Cessna at 15,000 feet, and suddenly his vision failed. He thought it was the sun, but then he realized it was much worse. He said, I couldn't see the dials in front of me. It was all a blur. I was helpless. It turns out that Jim had suffered a stroke. He groped around, he found the radio in his Cessna, and he issued a mayday alert. About that time, Paul Gerard, a Royal Air Force wing commander, was contacted by air traffic control, and he took off right away in Jim O'Neill's direction. He found the plane. He hovered about 500 feet above it, and he began talking to the stricken pilot. The commander reassured Jim and instructed him. He said, just take a gentle right turn, please, left a little more, raise up the nose, and he kept hovering over Jim's plane, and he shepherded Jim to the nearest airport. Now Jim's gonna have to land the plane by himself in faith. There's a BBC recording, I think it's on the internet, of the last 4 minutes, where the commander is saying, start another roll, nope, turn a little back, keep coming down over and over for 4 harrowing minutes. And then finally you hear the wing commander say, you are safe to land, let go of the controls. And he did. Jim made it. So let's trust God. He will get us our family home. Amen. Will the ushers please come forward? Thank you. us these gifts and use them to further your kingdom here, to your honor and glory forever. In Jesus' name. Please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come into your presence in your house. We are grateful for you sending your Son Jesus into the world and for your scripture by which you let us know you, know your Son, and know of your wonderful plan for us. Help us to know you better, Lord, to seek your face. Teach us, guide us by your Spirit. Protect us from evil and harm that we would not be grieved until the day that you call us home. Grant us your grace, your blessing, your joy, your peace. Grow the life of our Savior in us that we will not faint but live in persevering and overcoming faith. Heavenly Father, we pray for our Pastor Ellsbury, who's going into surgery this week. Be with him, Lord, and heal him, restore him to health. And we lift up to you, Lord, all those who are sick, known and unknown, for your healing power. And in our silent prayers, Lord, we lift up those, each of us, those whom we know that we pray for. We pray for the people of Israel, whom you love. We ask for your protection of them. We ask that you would be with them, Father, in their hour of need. Gracious Father, we are bold to pray as you have taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Please join me for the three verses of Blessed Assurance, number 67.
Thank you.
encouraged, emboldened, reassured in the love of God and our place in His family forever.